Good morning. Welcome to St. Gregory the Great. We are pleased to share this celebration with you. My name is Renee Boltry, and I will be your lector for this Mass. Our celebrant will be Father Dan, assisted by Deacon Greg. This Lent, please help meet important parish needs by volunteering. Many liturgical ministries are in great need. We need lectors, ushers, Eucharistic ministers, altar servers, substitute catechists, and more. We are looking for singers for the Holy Week Triduum Choir and volunteers to help run the Great Race and to run our Spirit and Life newsletter. Please see the bulletin for details. We have a great opportunity for St. Gregory the Great parishioners interested in becoming Eucharistic ministers. There will be a training held here Saturday, March 11th, from 10 a.m. to noon in the gathering rooms. To register, you do need to complete a diocesan application form and have one of our parish priests' signatures on it. To receive a form, please contact Joe Perino at the parish office. Upcoming this week are the beginning of adult confirmation classes, Friday fish fry at Andiamo Takeout Bistro to benefit St. Greg's, Stations of the Cross, pierogies and fish tacos on Wednesdays and Fridays at the cafe, and much more. Next weekend, after Mass, please look for the Youth Ministry M&M fundraising in the vestibule. The parish financial report is also in this week's bulletin. Please take and read the bulletin and discover all the life-giving ways God is working and waiting for you at St. Greg's. At this time, I ask you to stand and welcome those around you.
the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, as we gather to celebrate this first Sunday of Lent, let us call to mind our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask the Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and to you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting. Let us pray. Grant, Almighty God, through the yearly observances of Holy Lent, that we may grow in understanding of the riches hidden in Christ and be worthy, and by worthy conduct pursue their efforts. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Genesis. The Lord God formed man out of the clay of the ground and blew into his nostrils the breath of life. And so man became a living being. Then the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east and placed there the man whom he had formed. Out of the ground, the Lord God made various trees grow that were delightful to look at and good for food, with the tree of life in the middle of the garden and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now the serpent was the most cunning of all the animals that the Lord God had made. The serpent asked the woman, "Did God really tell you not to eat from any of the trees in the garden?" The woman answered the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden. It is only about the fruit of the tree in the middle of the garden that God said, 'You shall not eat it or even touch it, lest you die.'" But the serpent said to the woman, "You certainly will not die. No, God knows well that the moment you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like gods who know what is good and what is evil." The woman saw that the tree was good for food, pleasing to her eyes, and desirable for gaining wisdom. So she took some of its fruit and ate it. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized that they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. The word of the Lord.
merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned. Be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your merciful love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash me completely from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. Be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned. My transgressions, truly I know them. My sin is always before me. Against you alone have I sinned. What is evil in your sight I have done. Be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned. Create a pure heart for me, O God. Renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence. Take not your Holy Spirit from me. Be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned. Restore in me the joy of your salvation. Sustain in me a willing spirit. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall proclaim your praise. Be merciful, O Lord, for we have sinned.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, through one man, sin entered the world, and through sin, death. And thus, death came to all men, inasmuch as all sinned. For up to the time of the law, sin was in the world, though sin is not accounted when there is no law. But death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those who did not sin, after the pattern of the trespass of Adam, who is the type of the one who was to come. But the gift is not like the transgression. For if by the transgression of the one many died, how much more did the grace of God and the gracious gift of the one man, Jesus Christ, overflow for the many? And the gift is not like the result of the one who sinned. For after one sin, there was the judgment that brought condemnation. But the gift, after many transgressions, brought acquittal. For if, by the transgression of the one, death came to reign through that one, how much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and of the gift of justification come to reign in life through the one Jesus Christ. In conclusion, just as through one transgression condemnation came upon all, so through one righteous act, acquittal and life came to all. For just as through the disobedience of the one man, the many were made sinners, so through the obedience of the one, the many will be made righteous. The word of the Lord.
Brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
At that time, Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. He fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was hungry. The tempter approached and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." He said in reply, "It is written, one does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes forth from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and made him stand on a parapet of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you. And with their hands they will support you, lest you dash your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "Again it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test." Then the devil took him up to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in their magnificence. And he said to them, "All these I shall give you if you will prostrate yourself and worship me." And at that Jesus said, "Get away, Satan. It is written, the Lord your God shall you worship, and him alone shall you serve." Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. The
gospel wash away our sins.
I don't know about you, but I always struggle with the Ash Wednesday fast, so I very much like to eat. So by the time it gets to be about dinner time and I'm ready for my one partaking, I'm really getting really hangry at that moment. And all I can think about is like how I want to eat like half a horse because I'm so hungry. But then I think about, okay, I'm going through just a few hours of, you know, fasting and not eating, but then let's look at what our Lord does in today's gospel passage. He goes through 40 days without eating anything, which blows my mind because I don't think I could do that. But then science has told us that once you get to that 40-day mark, your body actually starts breaking down muscle because it's looking for nourishment. So Jesus was probably in pain in the desert after not eating for 40 days, hungry, longing for food. And then that's the moment that the devil decides to show up. And of course, he's very cunning. So the first thing he talks about is, oh, turn these stones into bread. Well, after not eating anything for 40 days, wouldn't a nice warm loaf of bread sound really tasty and really good? But of course, Jesus, you know, in his divine wisdom, is able to overcome this temptation. And we see that there's three different types of temptation that he goes through that all go with a the different effects of our concupiscence. So concupiscence is the effects of original sin from the original fall of Adam and Eve. So these are like the temptations that we constantly go through because of that original sin. And the first one is the lust of the flesh. So Jesus, even though he's fasting, he's preparing for his 40 days in ministry, he's tempted by the devil in order to want to go and turn the stones into bread. So what he has to do is he has to overcome this lustful idea of, you know, lusting over food. And then the next one is that the devil takes him, puts him on the top of the parapet of the temple, and he says, look at all of these, all the kingdoms and their magnificence, which means their riches. So this is the temptation of the pride of life. And as we can see, like, Jesus would be a great ruler over all these kingdoms, but he knows that he's called to worship and serve the one true God in heaven. So of course he dismisses the devil with that one. And then, I went to the third one. I apologize for that. Yeah, that's throwing himself in the kingdom. So that he would have been this great superstar, right? And then that would have given him all this power, but he drives away Satan. So that's the pride of the eyes, which is, it's like greed, you know, wanting to have more for ourselves than what's granted. And then, so the second one is to throw the self from the temple and have the angels catch you, which is would be, you know, a pride of life. So it's saying that we're worth more than what God's called us to. But Jesus is called to this ministry of humble service. It's not about self-aggrandizement and making myself look good, making himself look good, but it's all about being humble. So we see that Jesus is tempted to the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, but yet he overcomes all of these things. And this is a very important point, because when we go back to today's first reading from the book of Genesis, and we hear of the fall of Adam and Eve, and listen carefully to what Eve says about the food, about the tree of the fruit of knowledge. The woman saw that the tree was good for food, pleasing to the eyes, and desirable for gaining wisdom. So again, good for food is lust of the flesh. She just was desiring the object for what it was. Lust of the eyes is, or pleasing to the eyes is lust of the eyes or greed. Even though she knew that food was not hers to take, she still wanted it, and because she wanted more. And then of course, the gaining wisdom to become like God is the pride of life. You know, that's saying that, you know, they wanted to be like God and that God was holding something from her. So this is where we see that the fall of Adam and Eve, and as an aside, we attribute it to both of them because Adam should have protected Eve, and Adam also ate of the fruit as well. We see this fall of Adam and Eve is the complete reversal of what happens in today's gospel passage. So Jesus goes through the same three temptations, albeit in a little bit different way, and he overcomes them. So we see what he's doing is he is overturning the original power of sin and death. And this is where in today's second reading from St. Paul, we have this beautiful line that says, "For just as through disobedience of the one man, the Adam, the many were made sinners, all of us through original sin, so through the obedience of the one, Jesus, the many will be made righteous." And this is where Jesus' mission to die for our sins is what's called justification. We're not able to atone for this fall of our first parents, Adam and Eve, but that's what Jesus comes to do. He comes to, through the waters of baptism, to be able to wipe out that original sin. And this is why he goes through his passion, death, and resurrection, is to help us so that we can enjoy eternal life with heaven and to be reordered and to be brought closer to God. Now, when we look at these temptations, we have to understand that the devil is not very creative. So he always uses the same things over and over and over again. And I think if each and every one of us did an examination of conscience, we would see how we were really trapped by lust or greed or pride in different ways. So we always need to make sure that we have these kind of a mindset in our this idea in our head, so that when we're tempted by this, we can always overcome the devil. And Jesus gives us a great example of how to go about doing this by combating it with the Word of God. So if I'm tempted to lust, maybe it's over, you know, somebody, a person or an object, you know, maybe I want to think about, you know, having a humility of heart. You know, Psalm 51, create a clean heart in me, O God. If I'm tempted to greed, you know, maybe we can go to, think about how Jesus is always going against, like, you know, take Our Lady's Magnificat. He's cast on the mighty from the throne, he's lifted up the lowly. Or maybe we say a prayer of thanksgiving for the blessings that we do have, instead of just thinking about what we don't have. And then, of course, with pride, you know, just we can think about how lowly we are before God and how we are called to humble ourselves. You know, again, thinking about all the Psalms of humility and about how Jesus calls us to be like children. All of these things are good things to think about when we're in those thrones of temptation, because we can use Scripture to overcome them and to combat this evil. So today, as we examine and go through all of the temptations that Jesus did in the desert, let us not be afraid of the temptations that we're going to go through in these formative 40 days of Lent. Just like as I experienced on Wednesday, the definitely a lust for the flesh of food, so too we're all going to experience these things. But it's not something to be afraid of, but it's something to embrace. Because this is where we get to journey with Christ, just as Christ was tempted in the desert, so too we get to undergo those temptations. And that's what helps us to become more sanctified and more pure, and to have that heart that's more closely conformed to God. So may we utilize these formative 40 days of Lent to help us grow closer to God, to follow the example that he gives us in the gospel. And may we always have the courage to combat all our temptations with the words of Jesus and to draw on him and his example in our time of need. Let us together profess our faith using the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. As a people of prayer going through our Lenten journey, let us present our prayers and petitions to our Father in heaven.
For the Church, may this season of Lent be a time of greater prayer and fervent devotion for us and for all the Church. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all elected officials, may these days of Lent be marked by earnest efforts at peacemaking throughout the world. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our brothers and sisters in Turkey who have experienced another earthquake this past week, may the Lord help them move forward in the face of tragedy, strengthen the work of emergency teams, and console those who are bereaved or in despair. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have lost family members and friends due to gun violence, may the Lord gather us up and make us instruments of his peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all catechumens, may they be lifted in prayer by our parish family as they approach the Easter sacraments. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Peter X. Belanti, whom we pray for in a special way at this Mass, and for our own prayers and intentions, which we offer now in prayerful silence. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who have died in faith, may they be granted the rewards and blessings of the kingdom, especially those who have passed on this week from our parish and faith community. Dr. Herbert Simon, Ronald Sikirski, Lena Gress, Michael Militello, Salvatore Maggio Jr., Madonna Henderson, Terry Langham. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God, our Father, we ask to hear these prayers and answer them in accordance with your most holy will. And we ask this as we ask all things through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Our ushers will now take up the collection. Gift bearers this morning are Shirley Arklepain and Lindy Redmond.
Wilderness, bring us back. Turn our
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of God's name, for our good and the good of all God's holy church.
Amen. Give us the right dispositions, O Lord, we pray, to make these offerings, for with them we celebrate the beginning of this venerable and sacred time. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. By abstaining 40 long days from earthly food, he consecrated through his fast the pattern of our Lenten observance, and by overturning all the snares of the ancient serpent, taught us to cast out the leaven of malice, so that celebrating worthily the Paschal mystery, we might pass over at last to the eternal Paschal feast. And so with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim.
Sanctus, Sanctus, Sanctus Dominus Deus Sabaoth, plenis und celi et terra gloria tua, Hosanna in excelsis, benedictus qui venit in nomine Domini, Hosanna in excelsis.
To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these holy and unblemished these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant your peace to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Michael, our Bishop, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants. And all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you, for them we offer you the sacrifice of praise that they offer for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Florus, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints, we ask that through their merits and prayers in all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father. Giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Mysterium Fidei.
Ortem Tua Annunciamus Domine, et Tuam Resurrectionem confitem.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with a sign of faith and rest in a sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servant, to those sinners, hope in your abundant mercies. Graciously grant them share in fellowship through holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Per ipsum ecum ipso et in ipso, est tibi Deo omnipotenti, in unitate Spiritui Sancti, omnis honor et gloria, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other that same sign of Christ's peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Eagles.
Let us pray. Renew now with heavenly bread, by which faith is nourished, hope increased, and charity strengthened, we pray, O Lord, that we may learn to hunger for Christ, the true and living bread, and strive to live by every word which proceeds from your mouth. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We have a few announcements. This Lent, St. Greg's has partnered with Andiamo Takeout Bistro for our Lenten fish fries. You have to pre-order the dinners each week and pick them out at Andiamo and they're takeout only. For more information, please see the bulletin. They are serving a fried or baked fish and pizza by the slice. And there is one correction in the bulletin. It is fettuccine Alfredo and not linguine Alfredo. We have... These are important things to know. This Lent, we have a lot going on here at St. Greg's, a weekly Stations of the Cross with Holy Hour is going to be every Friday. Our Adoration Chapel will be closed at the time because there'll be Adoration going on here during church. On Wednesdays, we're doing a video series about confession, and then there will be a presentation given on the Shroud of Turin, as well as a St. Joseph's Day table for families. Our Lenten retreat this year topic is finding the joy and peace of God in our lives. Please see the bulletin for a full list of events. Adult confirmation classes start this week to be prepared to receive at the Easter Vigil, and please see the bulletin. Also, we are in need of many volunteers, as we mentioned at the beginning of Mass, but there's a special opportunity for extraordinary ministers of Holy Communion. We're going to be having a training here on Saturday, March 11th at 10 a.m. in the gathering rooms. You have to register for this to become a minister, so please call the parish office for more information about that. And we thank you all for your dedication and support, and we hope you have a wonderful week and a blessed Lent. The Lord be with you.
Let us bow our heads and pray for God's blessing.
May bountiful blessing, O Lord, we pray, come down upon your people, that hope may grow in tribulation, virtue be strengthened in temptation, and eternal redemption be assured. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit come down upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen. This Mass is ended. Let us go forth in peace to serve the Lord and one another.
Thanks be to God. Prayer for renewal. In every age, O God, you have called us to be your people, to be your church, In this time, we begin anew to discern the pathways that will lead us, your people, closer to you. Continually bless our journey as we proclaim your good news, celebrate your saving presence among us, serve others with charity and justice, and steward the world you have entrusted to our care. Send your Spirit to lead and guide our Emmaus journey as we commit ourselves to the renewal of our church. This we ask through Christ our Lord. Amen.
And snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the other evil spirits who prowl about the world, seeking the ruin of souls.